spouses, father, people that we are being a light to come to the knowledge of Yeshua, HaMashiach, in the Torah, the way the Torah is written out for us, Father. We just pray that you instill the Word of God in our lives. This lifestyle that we have, Father, is the same that you've given us, and your Word doesn't change. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Bless your people, Father, Yisrael. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem today, Father, that your appointed times coming up, the Moediems, Father, we pray that you would call and draw your people to yourself through these great feast days that are coming up. In Yeshua HaMashiach's name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And give God all the glory, all the honor and praise. Because he's an awesome God. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Hallelujah. Praise his name.
Bring it through with me. Get a privilege to the lead. So what you're gonna take upon your head, you can
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He's an awesome God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Shalom.
And then turn and
I want you to know that God's salvation has been sent to the Gentiles, and it will listen. For 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Hold on 1 minute, Stephanie. I'd like you to read verse number 23 again.
23. They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day and came in larger numbers to the place where he was staying. He witnessed to them from morning till evening, explaining about the kingdom of God and from the law of Moses, from the prophets. He tried to explain to them about it.
Okay, I'm going to read it from the King James. And when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him unto his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Yeshua, okay, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning until evening. There is just a different flavor between the object of that translation. What translation is that that you are using?
This one is the New International Version.
Okay. In the future, if you do have a King James, okay, read it out of that. Because that takes the object off of, it's just like, you know, concerning them, I'm trying to convince them about Yeshua is an afterthought. But this was very deliberate to say that he was teaching them about the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning, okay, and how it relates, how Yeshua relates to the kingdom based upon the Torah, okay, and the prophets. There's a reason, okay, once again, that you have to watch different, I'll say, not necessarily translations, but transliterations or even interpretations. The New International Version, I don't think, is technically called a translation, okay, of the Bible. So, you know, it's very important how Paul, that you understand what Paul was doing. He wasn't trying to convince them about Yeshua as an afterthought. He was directly relating how Yeshua relates to the kingdom of God. Because remember, you have to remember who is in the audience, where he is and who is in the audience. So he is relating to them once again as Yeshua being the fulfillment of the kingdom of God. The prophet, remember, he's showing him as the prophet that was spoken of by Moses out of the law and the prophets. Very important you understand how he was talking to the Jews with that. The New International Version is a Christian version that is far away from being able to relate to the Torah. Okay, it will not relate you to the Torah. In some cases, people say, well, it sounds, you know, it's easier, you know, easier to understand. It may be easier to understand, but it is not an exact translation, and it does lose some things in the interpretation of the scriptures. So, for unity's sake, we use the King James Version, okay, when we are reading. And the only reason for that is that when we have the key word study Bible, if there is a particular word that I can key into on there, we'll do that. So, thank you for reading. In the future, if you can read from the King James, it'll make it a lot easier because another reason for reading from the King James is that it is universally accepted, and once again, because of our audience being so broad, some who are in the church, some who are out of the church, you have those in the church that do not like certain interpretations, but the King James is readily accepted by all denominations, all. So for consistency's sake is one reason why we use the King James Version. All right, I think Eduardo is standing here patiently waiting for me to sit down so he can read. All right, there you go.
Thank you, Pastor. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Vamos a leer el libro de los Hechos del Apóstol Pablo. entregado preso en manos de los romanos, los cuales, cuando me interrogaron, quisieron ponerme en libertad, pues no encontraron causa para condenarme a muerte. Pero cuando los judíos se opusieron, me vi obligado a apelar al César, pero no porque tuviera acusación alguna contra mi pueblo. Por tanto, por esta razón, he pedido veros y hablaros, porque por causa de la esperanza de Israel llevo esta cadena. Y ellos le dijeron: nosotros ni hemos recibido cartas de Judea sobre ti, ni ha venido aquí ninguno de los hermanos que haya informado o hablado algo malo acerca de ti. Pero deseamos oír de ti que enseñas, porque lo que sabemos de esta secta es que en todas partes se habla contra ella. Y hablándole fijado un día, vinieron en gran número, dando él posada, y desde la mañana hasta la tarde les explicaba, testificando fielmente sobre el reino de Dios y procurando persuadirlos acerca de Jesús, tanto por la ley de Moisés como por los profetas. Algunos eran persuadidos con lo que se decía, pero otros no creían. Y al no estar de acuerdo entre sí, comenzaron a marcharse, después de que Pablo dijo una última palabra: bien habló el Espíritu Santo a vuestros padres por medio de Isaías el profeta, diciendo: ve a este pueblo y di: al oír oiréis y no entenderéis, y viendo veréis y no percibiréis, porque el corazón de este pueblo se ha vuelto insensible, y con dificultad oyen con sus oídos, y sus ojos han cerrado, y no se vean, y no lo ven con los ojos, y oigan con los oídos, y entiendan con el corazón. Sabed, por tanto, que esta salvación de Dios ha sido enviada a los gentiles, ellos sí oirán. Y cuando hubo dicho esto, los judíos se fueron, teniendo gran discusión entre sí. Y Pablo se quedó por 2 años enteros en la habitación que alquilaba y recibía a todos los que iban a verle, predicando el reino de Dios y enseñando todo lo concerniente al Señor Jesucristo, con toda libertad y sin estorbo. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Jesse.
Come up on my altar. I
fly as a cloud, and as it goes through the window. Surely, the isles shall wait for me, the ships of Persia first, through my sons from far, their silver and their gold from the sand, the name of the Lord thy God, the Holy One thy God, because he hath glorified me, and the sons of strangers shall build up thy wall, and their kings shall minister unto thee. For in my wrath I smote thee, but in my favor have I had mercy on thee. Therefore thy gates shall be open continually, they shall not be shut, they shall not be shut day nor night, that men may bring unto thee the forces of the Gentiles, and that their king may be brought. For the nation, the kingdom that will not serve thee shall perish. Yea, those nations shall be utterly wasted. The glory of Lebanon shall come unto thee. The fir tree, the pine tree, and the box together, beautify the place of my sanctuary. That will make the place of my feet glorious. The sons also of them that afflicted thee shall come, bending unto thee. And all they that despise thee shall bow themselves down at thy soul, at the soles of thy feet. They shall call thee City of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Whereas thou hast been hated, so that no man went through thee, I will make thee an eternal excellence, the joy of many generations. Thou shalt also suck the milk of the Gentiles, and shalt suck the breast of the king. And thou shalt know that I, the Lord, am thy Savior, and thy Redeemer, Mighty One of Jacob. For brass I will bring gold, for iron I will bring silver, for wood brass, for stone iron. I will also make thy opposite teeth, and thy exact is righteous. Violence shall no more be heard in thy land, wasting nor destruction within thy borders. So thou shalt call thy wall salvation, and thy gate praise. The sun shall be no more thy light by day, neither for the brightness shall the moon give light unto thee. For the Lord shall be unto thee an everlasting light, thy God, thy Lord. Thy sun shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon draw itself. For the Lord shall be an everlasting light, the days of thy mourning. Also shall be all righteous. They shall inherit the land forever. The branch of my planting, the work of my hand, that I may glorify. The little one shall become a fountain, the small one, the strong nation. I, the Lord, will take it in its time.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you. I'm going to read that again, and one reason that I don't have all the readings today is that I have a long lesson, so I want to get started early on it. I'm going to read that again out of the Tanakh. Before I do that, I want you to look at verse number 16 of Isaiah 60. Verse number 16 of Isaiah 60. I'm going to go on the last part of that. From the King James, it says that I, Yahweh, am thy Savior, and thy Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Now I'm going to read it out of the Tanakh. It says that I, Yahweh, am your Savior. I, the Mighty One of Jacob, am your Redeemer. Okay. Can you see a slight difference in your interpretation of those scriptures? The translation makes a big difference. Okay, in one putting, from the Tanakh, it relates that the same one who is the God of Jacob is the same one that is your Redeemer. Now, I want you to think about that, where Christianity went to separate the Jews from the Christian Gentiles. But here it is very clear to tell you that the one who is the Mighty One of Jacob is the same one that is your Redeemer. they have a double-edged, the Word of God can be a double-edged sword, you know, on both hands. There is just a difference in that interpretation, okay, when you look at the scripture, okay, from the Hebrew scriptures. And so that is one reason why when we read the Tanakh or the prophets, reading from the, once again, Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms, okay, so that we are getting the kind of same flavor from those as they would have back in that day, okay, also. So I always encourage you, whenever there is an Old Testament, okay, or a Torah and prophets reading, read it both out of your King James and out of your Tanakh, because you can sometimes get a more fullness of what, okay, they are saying when you're reading it out of the Hebrew interpretation of the scriptures. All right, so do I need to put on my hater blockers today? No?
No, 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 no.
Okay, you know, this lesson is I'll have to say, kind of a difficult lesson, and for the sake of everybody, because I know people don't have the Tanakh, let's go to our Torah portion, and we're going to start in Deuteronomy. Actually, 27. We'll start in Deuteronomy, probably 27. I have a lot of notes. All right. FYI, you should always read Deuteronomy 27 and 28 along with Leviticus chapter 26. Very important that you take those scriptures. Okay, those scriptures together. In fact, in your handout that I did for today, I think I put a chart. Yes, there was a chart in there representing a comparison. If you go to the, I think it is third page, maybe third page, color chart, using lots of ink. But a color chart, this chart represents a comparison of the seven seals in Revelation, okay, 6 and 7, to Matthew 24, Deuteronomy 28, Leviticus 26. Now, when I give you materials like this, guess what? These materials are your study materials, because we cannot get through all of this. Always understand that when you go up steps, okay, if you have, say, for example, 28 steps, you're not going to go on step one and jump your next step up to 28, right? Okay, if you try to do that, 9 times out of 10, what's going to happen? You're going to fall and do what? Hurt yourself. Okay, there is a reason why Yah has things set up the way he does. There is a reason why we review the Torah portions the way that we do. Because each Torah portion is a step. You understand what I'm saying? When you take one step at a time, you're constantly, we start at Genesis chapter 1. That high step is that last Torah portion, okay, in a Deuteronomy, all right? Deuteronomy is almost like a summary of the other four books. And then what do? Because it's a summary, we start all over again. Now, we take those steps down. It's easier for you to get back down to Genesis. And the reason for that is because now you're familiar with the steps. You understand, sometimes when you're going up steps and you're not sure where to place your foot or whatever, you go up a couple of times and then you automatically, you can do it without even holding on. All right, it's that first time going up those steps that sometimes you'll hold on to the handrail. You'll go on to the handrail going up, you'll hold on to the handrail going down. But once you are familiar with it, you start going up and down the steps quicker and quicker and quicker. In some cases, you can become so familiar with the steps that you start skipping every other step or whatsoever, okay, because you're more familiar, okay, with the steps. So winds up happening a lot of times is the materials that I give you help you to get up the steps so that when you don't take certain things in order, it's hard for you when you get back to the first step again because you're somewhere in between. You're not taking the steps. There's a logical process even to your brain, training your brain on how to read the Word of God. Because once you become familiar with the steps, when you go somewhere else and you see steps, your brain will automatically begin to calculate how to get up those steps, where to watch out for, if you need to hold on or if you don't need to hold on. The reason that we're training the way that we do is so that when you see scripture, no matter where it is, you're automatically going to put those scriptures through that, those steps. When you see something, you're going to put that, what you see or experience, through those steps automatically. That's part of what trying the spirit to see if it be of God is. You will automatically go through certain steps. So, if you really learn the lessons between Deuteronomy 28, Leviticus 26, you will recognize those lessons when you get to Revelation, when you get to Daniel, when you get to Revelation. Why? Because you've already seen the steps and the progressions. It gives you a better understanding of what to look for. Revelation, okay, you're going to learn. Revelation is in a form of a covenant. That may not mean a lot to a lot of people now, but when you understand a covenant, there are terms of covenants, there are blessings for obedience, there are sanctions for disobedience. A covenant is always given to a particular people, okay, and deposited with them. And so if you learn the lesson and study the lesson of Deuteronomy, you're going to recognize that in the book of Revelation, all right? So there is a natural progression because once you really study and get through Deuteronomy, Genesis is going to make so much more sense to you. As I was examining this Torah portion today, something hit me that I never saw before. I actually saw every step of creation within this week's Torah portion. All right, and there are certain things that, oh my goodness, it just begins to make sense. All right, Yah is the same. In today's title, I'm kind of, I don't want to say struggling with the title. I have two, and I'm not sure of which one. One of them is, we are not there yet, as opposed to, are we there yet? You know, we are not there yet. And then the other one is the same God. So by the time we get finished, okay, I'll decide which one it is. I figure I'll get that over with. So anyway, I'm going to give this to you exactly the way that I received it. And this is over several days' time, since Thursday, going all the way to even this morning. So it's kind of out of order, but in order at the same time, because the first thing he had me studying was from Leviticus chapter 26, okay? And you always, when you're studying, especially Deuteronomy 28, study Leviticus chapter 26. One of the reasons that I say that, Leviticus is a book spoken out of whose mouth? Whose mouth?
Yahweh.
Okay. I needed everybody consensus. Okay. It's spoken out of the mouth of Yahweh. All right. Does that mean anything to anyone?
Yes.
Okay. It's spoken out of the mouth of God directly. In view of that, does he really care what we think about it?
No.
Okay. Is he asking our opinion on whether, how do you feel about this? Okay.
No voting.
Okay, there is no voting. Okay. So once we understand that, and see, you must understand that. Whenever you see something spoken out of the mouth of God, always remember, understand what I'm saying? Okay. Too often we look at the Bible and we want to see if I can make it apply to me or whether it doesn't apply to me. When something is spoken out of the mouth of God, that is the same voice that spoke creation into existence. You understand? So, obedience, and I need you to understand this. Obedience really should not be an option. If obedience is an option, there's nothing wrong with the word. There's everything wrong with you. Okay? All right? This is the realization that I'm getting. Okay? Today, some of the things that I saw made me so nauseous. I wasn't sure I was going to be able, when the realization of certain things hit me today, it was like in the pit of my stomach. And that peanut butter sandwich I had almost didn't make it to stay down. Okay, that's how drastic it was. It hit me. The implications of what it is we do and how we approach this word. All right, so I'm going to give this and read through, and then we're going to go back and read some other things. For Yom Kippur, we are actually going to be going over the seven indications of a curse in detail. That's going to be one portion of what it is that we are going to be doing. So we have quite a full schedule, okay, for Yom Kippur to go over. I gave you, last week handed out, or rather, the Psalms for Mikvah. You should be using that. And this last week, because just think about it, Rosh Hashanah, New Year, okay, is really a week. I think it is a week from Monday. A week from Monday. So we are there. This is the time to go before God. Okay, and just really sanctify, set yourself apart, make it right, okay, make restitution, okay, if necessary, okay, get things right before God, because there is a shift, really a shift. The theme, I think, for Sukkot, for the weekend that we are going, I'm going to be doing extensive teaching on signs in the heavens. That's what he's given me, the signs in the heavens. Okay, a lot has been going on that people don't pay attention to because we are too focused on earthly craziness right now. Okay, so we're not paying attention to what God is doing. All right, what God is doing. And it's very important to understand that a shift has happened. Okay, a shift has happened. A shift so significant in the spiritual, the earth has shifted on its axis. You understand how significant? The earth has shifted on its axis. That sets everything that happens on earth, okay, in motion, which is one reason why when people start talking about global warming and all that, a shift, for the earth to shift out from its original axis. That's very significant. However, we also know that global warming can be a very veiled reference to some, to Baal, who is the storm god. Okay, and so once again, these are things that we are going to look at, not exploring craziness, because we got craziness out there, okay, going on. People take something and they start running with it, and next thing you know, they're off into craziness. So, certain things that he had me selah on, okay, starting last night. The authority of one covenant does not annul the authority of the previous. These are things to lean back and think about. The authority of one covenant does not annul the authority of a previous covenant. Now, that is a very New Testament teaching, all right, from Galatians chapter 3, I think it is Galatians 3, verse number 17. Paul is teaching this. And I say that the covenant that was confirmed before God in Christ, you need to turn to this. Turn to this, and I want you to see this and highlight this, because the impact of this, okay, needs to really hit you. All right? Galatians chapter 3, verse 17. This is Paul teaching the Galatians. Were the Galatians Gentiles?
Yes.
Important to understand who the audience is. Remember, Paul is in Galatians when the controversy comes up that requires him to go where? Into Jerusalem for the Jerusalem Council in Acts chapter 15. So if you're going to read the book of Galatians, you must read the book of Galatians in reference to Acts chapter 15. Okay, also. So, he goes on in verse number 17. And I say this, that the, okay, remember what the thought was. The authority of one covenant does not annul the authority of a previous covenant. So if you don't know your covenants, that's going to be a problem, right? Mm-hmm. All right? So anyway, he goes, and I say this, that the covenant that was confirmed before God, underlined God in Christ. How was this particular covenant confirmed in God?
In Christ.
The Torah. I don't hear anybody going, oh my God. So you mean the Torah or the Mosaic Covenant? Paul is teaching that the Mosaic Covenant was confirmed before God in Christ. Remember the confirming of the covenant when they sprinkled the blood, he slew the animals and sprinkled the blood upon the people, and how Yeshua says that at the end of the gospel, that this is my blood of the covenant, which is shed for many. You remember that? So Paul, and I'm making a point of this, Paul teaches us that the Torah was confirmed in Christ, which was 430 years after what? The Abrahamic covenant. So he's pointing back to the Abrahamic covenant. So in other words, the Mosaic covenant did not, what, annul the Abrahamic covenant. Your covenant does not annul the law or the Abrahamic covenant. Cannot disannul that it should make the promise of none effect, for if, and then he goes, if the promise be of the Torah, the promise wasn't of the Torah. Okay, the Torah was given after the Abrahamic covenant. It is no more promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. So in other words, if you want to understand components of the Mosaic covenant, it's based upon the Abrahamic covenant. So we take the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the Deuteronomy. Another name, by the way, for the covenant of Deuteronomy is called the Palestinian covenant. Let me let that sink in again. Deuteronomy is also called the Palestinian covenant because it was based upon them inherited the land that is called Palestine. Okay, so it's called the Palestinian covenant. So, we need to understand that. Now, the requirement of faith in Abraham was not replaced by the law under Moses. Therefore, faith is still binding upon anyone's relationship to the God of Abraham. Now, we're putting everything in relationship because we are heirs of Abraham through what? Faith in Yeshua. We are heirs of Abraham. This is why it's important for you to understand the Abrahamic covenant and how each covenant builds upon the Abrahamic covenant. Okay? Paul also says in Ephesians that we are heirs to the what? Covenants of promise. The heirs of the covenants given to Israel. So he's always, now understand something. It is the assumption that you already understand about the relationship between the covenant of Abraham and the Mosaic covenant. Why? Because Paul taught them of our relationship with the God of Abraham. All right? Now, understand something. Yeshua HaMashiach is who? The same yesterday, today, and forever. Why are the covenants the same? We have the same God. We have the same God. And God whose word does not change. He is the same. Therefore, Yeshua, if you say he is the God, or rather the Bible saying in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, all things created by him and for him, and without him was not anything created that was created. If you say he is the creator, he is the same today, which is what? Creator, as he was when he spoke creation into existence. I'm being very basic with this because people still have a problem with, should I apply the Torah? Should I do this? Should I do that? In spite of the fact that I'm seeing that this is spoken out of the mouth of God. All right? Now, judgments, the judgments and chastisements in Revelation are rooted in the curses of Leviticus 26 and 28. You need to understand that. Revelation is how he is going to reconcile the entire earth or world to himself. And he does what? If you look at Revelation in view of Genesis begins, in the beginning, the earth was void and without form, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And then God said, let there be light. All through Revelation, what do we see? We see a devolution or a de-evolution of creation. We see the earth doing what? Becoming void once again. And then in Revelation 21 and 22, what do we see? A new creation again. The old has passed away and a new comes again. All right? So you always have to look at, when you're looking at both Leviticus 26, Deuteronomy 28, your mind needs to be on both Revelation as well as Genesis. But guess what? If you are not taking the steps the way that you should, and you are skipping all over the place, you can never see it. Because your mind is not trained to look for the steps. Now, the principles of reward and or chastisements are the same. The basic principles or foundations for chastisements and rewards are the same. Why, once again? Because God is the same. The nature and holiness of God demands consequences of sin in the life of his people. His holiness demands that there be consequences for sin. Okay, lessons for the believers today are based upon history. Okay, people don't understand. Go to 1 Corinthians 10, verse 11. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 11. All right? If you want to know what God is going to do in the future, stop going to soothsayers. If you want to know what God is going to do in the future, you must understand what he did in the past. In 1 Corinthians 10, verse 11, now all these things happened to them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come, the ends of this age. So if you want to know what's going to happen in the future, look at what happened in the past, when the same things occurred. All right? You don't need a prophet today. started having me extremely sick. Galatians chapter 6. Let's go back to Galatians, book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 6. I'm feeling my stomach getting funny now. Galatians, what did I say? Okay. Verse number 7. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, so shall he reap. Whatsoever a man soweth, so shall he reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. And Leroy, let's take a break. Here's a keyword study Bible right here. Okay, that you can use. All right? Right, that one right there, that brown one. Mm-hmm. Take care of that. That's the Holy Grail of keyword studies. Okay, you see, thank you, thank you. Okay, throughout the year, you see it's well used. Okay, that was one of my original keyword study Bibles. Don't let it disappear. I don't want to see it on eBay or Amazon. All right. Be not deceived. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. All right. Be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a nation soweth, that shall that nation also reap. On purpose. Do I need to put on my hater glasses? Okay. Okay. Always remember, this is a war room. Okay? Two people. One has a problem. Why? The other has a solution. This is the reason why. Okay. When we are here, it is because we're going over, this is the reason why. This is why you are seeing. The message of the prophet is always about the why you are seeing and what you have to do to turn it around. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life ever after. Two realms. Earth as it is in heaven, flesh and spirit. You reap corruption in your flesh, guess what you're going to receive. Now, if you reap corruption in the spirit, guess what you're going to receive? The same. Okay. So, we also have 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 31 to 32. And I'm just setting the tone once again for our Torah portion. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Setting principles. Okay? This week is what you should be doing. Looking at our lives based upon the Torah. You understand what I'm saying? Because a time of the execution of judgments is coming. The only way that God is going to judge his people is by the Torah he has given them. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? Now, Romans 15:4. Well, we're all in Paul's business this week. Verse number 4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. You see, all of this is not about doom and gloom. All of this is about if this, then this. You want to turn it around, that these are the things you need to do. See, let me tell you something. Torah made serving God so easy for me. Torah made serving trying to teach something different. We then can go and decide how we're going to be obedient, or if we need to, go before God and ask for mercy. Always understand, mercy does not eliminate the consequences of sin. Mercy lessens the consequences of sin. Too often, we want God to take away the consequence. Am I right? We don't want to go through. No, it doesn't happen that way. Okay, mercy lessens the consequences of sin. All right, so understand that. All right, next thing. Covenant terms must be communicated with the covenant recipients. Okay? Commandments, statutes, ordinances, and laws or instructions must be conveyed and a record of the agreement held for future generations. You understand? That's why he told Moses, do what? Write it down. That's another reason why Moses went over from Deuteronomy 1:1 all the way to the end of Deuteronomy, okay, 27, 28, and 29. That technically kind of is the end of the covenant. Then we have the blessings and all that kind of stuff. Okay. The covenant terms have to be communicated with those that the covenant is covering. That's why I ask Christians all the time, what is your covenant? Oh, we're in the new covenant. What does that mean? I don't know. That's what I was told. Okay. Well, it's the blood of Yeshua. What does that mean? If you don't understand, the blood of Yeshua ratifies the terms of your covenant. How are you going to know whether you are obedient or disobedient? So stuff happens. We hear that all the time. Stuff happens. And then we go and we try to pray and ask for mercy. Let me tell you something. Mercy lessens the consequences. I see people suffering, suffering, suffering. They don't understand why they are suffering. And the whole thing why they are suffering is because no one will go and tell them the Torah, they violate it. Yeah. That they violate it. All right. So they suffer. All right. Now, getting right, listen, getting right with God does not ensure immediate blessing and the solution for your circumstances. I hear people all the time, I'll do this and ask for forgiveness later. You do this, you set something in motion. Okay. And that's willful sin, of which there is no recovery from that. Okay. Mercy might mean that instead of it taking 6 months, it takes 6 weeks. Mercy, sometimes you ask God for mercy, and the person passes away. You don't understand that. God, I was praying, why did they pass away? Because God gave that person mercy. They were ready to meet him. The key is, are they not ready to stay with you? The key is, are they ready to meet their God? Mercy will sometimes have God take a person early. It's a very sobering. I'm not going to put on my hater blockers because I think this is something that needs to sink in with people. All right. Mercy. And my prayer usually is, God, either heal them or take them. Heal them or take them. God gets no glory out of his saints' suffering. You understand what I'm saying? God gets no glory out of his saints' suffering. And very often, when I'm praying with the family, and then walk in the room, sometimes I know that person is not there. They are not there. Machines are on, but the person isn't there. Okay? And I'll ask the family, were they ready to meet God? And they say yes. And I say, now you let them go. You let them go. hardest thing is letting someone go. All right? But for mercy's sake, it is better to be with him than to spend another minute down here. Come on. That's always the objective. All right? Now, once again, getting right with God does not ensure immediate blessing or solution of your circumstances. Okay? It does not guarantee a restoration to the covenant position where blessings might come once again. It doesn't guarantee all the time. Okay, consequences may be alleviated. And you may have what is perceived a blessing based upon the hell. If you are on fire, the blessing is they put you out with the hose and you're no longer on fire, okay? But let me tell you something. There's no guarantee your skin and everything else are going to go back the way it was before. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, people don't understand that. They want God to be a genie in a Bible. Poof, and everything is all right. Doesn't always happen that way. Set expectations. God is going to restore Israel according to the Abrahamic covenant. But look at everything Israel's going to have to go through to get there. You understand what I'm saying? We are Israel. Okay. Don't you think it would have been better if they hadn't sinned in the first place? Am I right? All right. Restitution. This is hard. It's going to get harder. You need some tissue. Anybody need some tissue? Restitution not only involves the full application of the consequences of sin, but also the full application of that which is right within the covenantal relationship. Restitution. When you break, that's why Yahweh says in Leviticus 26, let's go to Leviticus 26. Leviticus 26, verse 40.
It's right here.
All right.
It's right here.
I don't know. Can you go see what that is? Sounds like a fan. Let's we'll see if it's on. Leviticus 26, verse number 40. If they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary to me, and I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies. I want you to think about this. They sinned. Yahweh said, if you sin, I'm going to bring you into the land of your enemies. They sinned, and oh, we're sorry, we're sorry. Guess what? The full consequence of that sin means you get kicked out. You understand what I'm saying? For God to be a just God, it means the penalty, full penalty, must be exacted. You still get kicked out. You may be allowed entrance back in, but you must be kicked. This is hard. Read the prophets. You understand what happens in Jeremiah when they're praying and all of this, and God says, thank you very much for your prayer, but we could have resolved this a whole lot earlier if you had done right the first time I came to you, but since you didn't now, Nebuchadnezzar's going to come, then you're going to go to the land of your enemies, you are going to stay there for 70 years, and then afterwards I'll bring you back in restoration. That's the fullness of the consequences that you have to admit. Let's read it again. Verse 41. and that I also have walked contrary unto them and have brought them into the land of enemies. If then, where are they? In the land of their enemies, their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept the punishment. You've got to accept that the punishment and what you are going through right now is right. It's not fair. Why me? Guess what? If God hadn't been merciful, you would have died in your sin. Understand what I'm saying? So not only did you sin, you must accept the consequences of your sin. You must also say, Yahweh is righteous. The foot upside my head is exactly where I should be right now, getting kicked in the side of my head for what it is I did. You're right. You understand what I'm saying? People don't want to hear that. They don't want to hear that. Okay, don't want to hear that. Guess what? You know why we have the Torah? Because the Torah teaches you what sin is. So if you have the Torah and you see what sin is and you still choose to do it, then you chose the kick in the head. Don't blame nobody. It's personal responsibility. What Torah reveals is everyone has a personal responsibility for their actions. The only one who anyone can blame is themselves. All right? When you're going to pray for people, it's a hard message, but if you want to get them healed, you got to bring them through the way God says to bring them through. Restitution not only involves the full application of the consequences of sin, but also the full application of that which is right in the covenantal of relationship of Yahweh to the land. Okay? Which means for full restitution, it is that which is right. You must experience the full and just consequences of the sin. Mercy can lessen the consequences, but you will still go through consequences. Some people hear stuff like that. Well, why am I ever either going to bother to serve God then? Hey, we can make it easy. Here's a gallon of gasoline and a match. Just pour it over your head and set the match. Okay, set the match now. Burn now and avoid the rush on doomsday. Okay, because if a heart says that, that is the very reason they're in the condition they're in right now. You understand what I'm saying? Attitude. What considers or determines altitude, whether it be up or down. All right? Now, understand something. Even in the land of your enemies, Yahweh is still our God. Oh, come on. You don't understand. Even in the land of our enemies, the one hope that we have is Yahweh is still our God, and Yahweh will always be faithful to his word. That is the greatest hope. His covenantal relationship with us transcends any geographical or even political boundaries. You understand what I'm saying? We are so caught up in I am this and I am that. If Yahweh is your God, it don't. Hallelujah. When you submit to the government of God, then the kingdom of God, the covenantal kingdom of God, supersedes the will of the government of man. You understand what I'm saying? Stop making men gods. Always understand, exile is the scattering among the nations. Are we in exile? Yeah. Is Israel still in exile? Yes. Don't say no, because there is a land of Israel. Israel is still in exile. That's important to understand. In exile, you are in servitude of the government whose land you are in. You don't understand these principles, you can't build upon them, you're not going to be able to prosper. Okay. When you are in exile, you are in servitude to the one whose government of the land you are in. When Israel was ruled by Rome, they were in servitude. Is that thing off?
It sounds like a border.
Anyway, okay, when Rome ruled Israel, they were in servitude to who?
Rome.
Whose laws did they have to follow?
Rome.
Okay.
Caesar's.
What did Yeshua say about that? Render unto God the things that are God. Anybody remember reading that in the Bible?
Yes.
Do you know what that means?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? No, don't go making Caesar. Yeah, true. Don't go making Caesar your God. But guess what? If you got it. You got it. You are subject to Caesar's rule. Why do people not prosper in the land? Yes. They commit treason against the government of the
land.
And where you so right, Jeremiah. When they rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar, it brought death to them.
Yes.
You don't understand that. See, we are still too fleshly. I was speaking to Andrea. I said, I really need everybody to come to the altar and get the real Holy Ghost this time. Get the real Holy Ghost. Because the real Holy Ghost will lead you and guide you and tell you how to govern and how to go in between. Pray like Solomon did. Teach me how to come in and go out amongst the people.
Amen.
That should be your prayer. Wisdom. And thank you, Brad, for those wisdom scriptures. They are really, really, okay, setting me on fire in the morning as I sit and think about those wisdom. Ask God for wisdom on how to go in and come out amongst the people. If you are in rebellion to the government of the land, you cannot benefit by the covenant of that government.
Amen.
You are in sedition, rebellion, and treason, both on high as well as on earth, heaven and earth. Because Yeshua said, if this is Caesar, we render unto Caesar that which is Caesar. Go get a coin and pay your taxes. It is always Yeshua that sets the standard. And those who go against the standard do not understand Yeshua. What happened after his ascension, and I think it was 126, the Bar Kokhba revolution, they chose another Messiah that went against the government, and hundreds of thousands of Jews were killed. God did not give them blessing because, oh, they are my chosen people in the land. I hear that so much, it makes me want to puke. Wickedness is wickedness. He doesn't care where geographically you are. He is the same God. Same God. Continue reading, okay? The judgments of God are not contrary or detrimental to his covenants. They establish a proper perspective regarding disobedience and sin. Judgments expose sin for what it really is. judgments also identify the authority that is behind the covenant. Who determines the judgment? Whoever the ruler is. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? Judgments will increase to such, and when we're reading Leviticus 26, to such an intensity and nature that there would be no doubt that Yahweh was behind it all. Mm-hmm. Okay, and this is where I begin to flip out a little bit. Because regardless of everything we see, the floods, the rains, the fires, and all of this, we still want to attribute it to global warming and not the hand of God. So it is only going to get worse, yes, until we fall on our face and ask God to save us. What is it going to take? A category 13 tornado or hurricane? You remember that movement, the day after tomorrow? Okay, is it going to take something like that? Chastisements are intended as a means of restoration. Always remember that. God chastises as a means of restoration to lead us to repentance. All right? And the purpose, however, is not to lead you to repentance ultimately, but to glorify God. It brings your focus to glorify God. Okay? Now, understand something. Retribution, however, can be terminal for those who are unrepentant. If you are repentant, unrepentant, God's judgment will result in death. Stay away from people who don't want to repent. Chastisements result in restoration through repentance. Okay? The judgment of Yahweh, okay, comes because of non-observance of the Sabbath, worship of idols, okay, and if you're writing, non-observant of the Sabbaths. Want to know why all these judgments? Come on. Non-observant of the Sabbaths. Are we a nation that observes his Sabbaths? Okay, judgment comes on a nation because of non-observant of the Sabbaths, the worship of idols, and the defilement of the people among whom God dwells. We call ourselves one nation under God. Do you understand? One nation under God. The judgment of Yahweh, non-observant of Sabbaths, based upon that, if we're one nation under that God, then judgments on the land are going to come exactly for the same reasons they came before. Non-observant of the Sabbaths, worship of idols, defilement of people among whom God dwells. Not because the Supreme Court did this, not because of that, not because of the other things, and I keep saying to you, the other things that are going on are symptoms of something very wrong. Abortion? Oh, God is going to, okay, really judge us because of abortion. God is going to judge us because we allow homosexuals to marry. Those are symptoms of something that was very wrong. Okay, to begin with, if it wasn't wrong on the inside, we would have never had those symptoms allowed. If we were truly one nation under God, people would fear God and not do certain things. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? Now, our time here, now here's where I started. Our time belongs to Yahweh. Our time belongs to Yahweh. Why? Because we are Israel, right? Do I have any Israelites in the house? We are Israel and have been set apart to him. So our time belongs If you aren't sure whether or not you are Israel, then you cannot benefit of the covenant, but you will experience. You will experience the curses. We've been set apart. Our failure to observe the Sabbaths places us in the position of denying the lordship of Yahweh over us. Our failure to observe the Sabbath says that Yahweh isn't our Lord. Sabbath signifies God's dominion over Israel, His sovereignty over Israel. It involves His establishment as Israel as a nation, His gift of the land to Israel, and His demand upon the time of Israel. You understand what I'm saying? This is not your day. Sabbaths are a means of remembering our history concerning our deliverance from bondage. Now, over, and this is what really made me a little bit sick here. One statement, let me find it here, about the Sabbath. I need you to, go to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, let's look at verse number, let's start at verse number 1. Okay. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended His work which He had made, and He rested on the seventh day from all His work which He had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in He had rested from all His work which God created and made. So what really, as we're looking at that, and He keeps repeating the same thing about the work that He had made, what does God do on the seventh day?
Rest.
And what? From what?
From His creation, for working.
Okay, so it gives the opportunity to Him resting and tying in His work. His resting is where He is examining all the work that He had done. So when you enter into the Sabbath and rest, what is Yah also doing?
Admiring everything that He did.
What is He doing? Also doing. Huh?
Examining us.
Oh! You got it. Sabbath is where you enter in. You don't work, but Sabbath is where you enter in with Yahweh, and He examines all the work you have done.
He's never resting.
That's why we don't work. We don't work. It's where we enter in. He rests from His work. He looks, all His work was good, and He rests begin working again with him, okay, on that first day. That's where I kind of got a little nauseous. Okay, got a little nauseous. Because I want to ask you, what did you do for Yahweh last week? When we look at the intensity of the Sabbath, Sabbath is not our time, it is his time. Never choose to do on Sabbath what you can do on another day. I'll tell you, you set certain things in motion because it is his time. And because it is his time, he can transcend time. See, we don't still don't understand this thing, okay, about you don't keep the Sabbath. The Sabbath keeps you. When we acknowledge our needs above certain things, you bring into effect clauses in Haggai chapters 1 and 2. Get a chance to read that. Now, let's go to Deuteronomy 28. The end of Deuteronomy 27. Okay. End of Deuteronomy chapter 27 begins a clause that you need to pay attention to. Cursed be he that confirmeth not all the words of the Torah to do them, and all the people shall say.
Amen.
All right. Deuteronomy 27 is where the people come into agreement with Yahweh over certain things. We're going to start at 27, verse number 11. And Moses charged the people the same day, saying, "Thee shall stand upon Mount Gerizim to bless the people when ye are come over Jordan. Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Joseph, and Benjamin. And thee shall stand upon Mount Ebal to curse Reuben, Gad, and Asher, Zebulun, Dan, and Naphtali. And the Levites shall speak and say unto the men of Israel with a loud voice, Cursed be the man that maketh any graven or molten image, an abomination unto Yahweh, the work of the hands of the craftsmen, and putteth it where?
Secret
place. And all the people shall answer and say,
Amen.
So, what is this kind of giving you a hint? These are going to be things that are done where?
Secret.
Okay. And remember, secret things belong to Yahweh. Why do secret things belong to him to deal with? What gives him the authority, okay, to deal with them? We all said, amen. So, secret idolatry. See, sometimes you wonder what happens to people. You don't understand. You didn't see anything. All you saw there, you know, and I hear, I'm coming to service, I pay my tithe, I do this, I do that, and bang! Secret things. Cursed be that setteth light by his father or his mother, and all the people shall say, amen. How you handle mother and father. Cursed be he that removeth his neighbor's landmark. And all the people shall say, amen. Cursed be he that maketh the blind to wander out of the way. Now, that's blind, person who is physically blind, and it can be someone who is also spiritually blind. Okay. A blind person needs to see where to go. So they may come to you and ask you to lead them a certain place. And if you lead them to a place that can cause them harm, we've already said, cursed be he that maketh the blind to wander out of the way. That's why I tell people, be very careful when you're giving all these teachings and all this kind of stuff to people. Okay, because if it causes them to go a wrong way, as long as they are in the realm of death, so will you be. Cursed be he that perverteth the judgment of the stranger, fatherless and widow. And all the people shall say,
amen.
Is this judgment for one people who are under God?
Yes.
Okay. Cursed be he that lieth with his father's wife, because he uncovereth his father's skirt. And all the people shall say,
amen.
Cursed be he that lieth with any manner of beast, and all the people shall say,
amen.
Now let me ask you something. Are these things that are going to be done out and open?
No.
They're going to be done in secret, right? Okay. Cursed be he that lieth with his sister, the daughter of his father, or the daughter of his mother, and all the people shall say,
amen.
What is the result of this curse? Death. You understand? Cursed be he that lieth with his mother-in-law, and all the people shall say,
amen.
Cursed be he that smiteth his neighbor secretly. You know what that is? Oh, at the service. Did you see what so-and-so did?
Gossip.
Okay? Smiteth his neighbor secretly, and all the people shall say, I didn't hear nobody.
Amen.
Okay, no, people don't want to say amen. Guess what? We said it for you. Okay? Cursed be he that taketh reward to do what? Slay an innocent person, and all the people shall say, amen. I had to get real tore up with somebody on Facebook about lies. Don't call yourself a Christian. Don't call yourself a Christian or a Torah believer and do certain things. Okay. Because you can bring upon a curse upon yourself and everybody who is influenced by that lie. Come on. Cursed be he that confirmeth not all the words of the Torah to do them, and all the people shall say amen. This is the curse of the law. Been wondering what the curse of the law is. This is the curse. Okay, now. Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 14 are the blessings. Okay, Deuteronomy 15 to 68 are the curses. What does that tell you?
More,
okay. Your blessings fall into several categories. If you're writing, productivity, being able to produce. Shalom. Power, population, provision, and God's presence. Understand that? Those are how the blessings come. Areas of productivity, peace, power, population, provision, and presence. All those. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. All right. So when we're looking at the blessings for disobedience, and I'm going to have to come back and do this as a Thursday night lesson to be able to go into the fullness. I want to go into, real quick, what I saw today. All right. That wasn't real pleasant. Mm-hmm. We started out what you sow, you're going to reap. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse number. Let's look at 49. Yahweh shall bring a nation against thee from afar, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. A nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, no show favor to the young. And he shall eat the fruit of thy cattle and the fruit of thy land until thou be destroyed, which also shall not leave thee either corn, wine, or oil, or the increase of thy kine or flocks of thy sheep until he has destroyed thee. and he shall besiege thee in all thy gates until thy high and fenced walls come down, wherein thou trusted throughout all thy land, and he shall besiege thee in all thy gates throughout all thy land, which Yahweh thy Elohim hath given thee. It'll get so bad you begin to eat the fruit of your own body. Okay. We talked about what you sow, you are going to reap. What you sow, you are going to reap. Now, I want you to look at this. God is telling him he will bring a nation from afar against Israel. What was Israel to the Canaanites? A nation from afar that came in, regarded neither old nor young. Okay. Measure for measure. You need to write that down. Measure for measure. Because that's a very important principle that is going on right now. Measure for measure. What you sow, you shall reap. Measure for measure. Okay. This makes me sick. Okay. Let's look at this. Measure for measure. So Yahweh is going to bring a people. Okay, let's put Israel in the land. Yahweh is going to bring a people that are going to come from afar. That means they probably have to come by ships or planes. And they are going to come against the natives of that land. And they are ultimately going to destroy the natives of that land, besiege them, destroy them, take all their land, take all of their produce and everything for their own, and besiege them so that they become servants to them. Isn't that what he said? We apply that to Israel, right? Mm-hmm. How come we never apply that to the history of the United States? Oh, go back. Go back. Let's go to the Native Americans. Who came over here in ships, a nation from afar, whose language they didn't understand, who regarded not the old or the young? If we look at measure for measure and what we sow, we reap, what has to happen again? A nation has to come from afar whose language we don't understand, who is not going to regard young or old, who is going to take all of our economy and turn it upside down. On ships, originally pilgrims, all that, came here on ships and became a terror to the natives of this land and put them in bondage. Okay, that's one phase. Phase two. Now, they came here, the people who came here on ships were free people who placed the natives of the land in bondage. Then there was a group of people who were forcibly brought here on ships in bondage and terrorized. So one group came over on ships as free people and terrorized the natives of that land. Another people were brought over on ships and terrorized within the land. One is a nation from outside coming in. The other is a nation that was brought from the outside, but the terror was within the land. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. What you sow, you are going to reap. Okay. Real silent. Bring in free people. Terrorize the people of the land. So if we go measure for measure, there are going to be a group of people that are going to come into this land, all right, and with them bring terror to the natives of the land. However, there's going to be a group of people who are already within the land that are going to bring terror to the people in the land. And all of this is because of disobedience to God. Oh, America. Oh, America. Oh, America. If we are truly one nation under God, payday is coming. And we are seeing it. And we still don't want to acknowledge our sin. It's so-and-so's fault. It's this one's fault. It's that one's fault. It is our fault. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear and will forgive and will live a lifestyle, okay, to be able to go sighing and crying, to see it, oh God, I see this, there's only going to be one remedy for this. You understand what I'm saying? And guess what, it's not going to be the government, it's going to be the church coming around and getting to the people and telling the people what they need to do.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying? Because guess what, when you sin, there are going to be consequences. And with unrepentance, consequences can be terminal. We're seeing all of these components. A nation brought in from afar. Ooh, that was 9/11, right? That was 9/11, right? Why don't we go back to December 1941, Pearl Harbor. Come on. The start. Not 9/11. 9/11 wasn't the start. And what did the nation do? See, God's kingdom transcends geography and political boundaries. He is judging every single nation exactly the same way right now. You understand what I'm saying? If you don't understand the reason why things are going on, you can never help the what and how. You understand what I'm saying? When you are praying, what I'm giving you right now is ammunition to know how to pray. Number one, we need to pray for mercy. Because mercy lessens the consequences. Mercy lessens the consequences. Blood for blood. There must be blood for blood. You know why I am so terrified? Because this nation will not deal. Thank you for that sneeze. That nation will not deal with the problem that we are having right now. With innocent blood being shed. I'm not talking about abortion. Abortion is wrong. The problem is not abortion laws. The problem is the hearts of people who want to have an abortion. So that's beside. Women's reproductive rights are not a problem. Okay? That's a heart problem. But innocent blood being shed. My fear is that if payback comes, who will be left? Because we will not acknowledge this problem.
in several decisions, and some of them sometimes I wonder whether or not I should stay with Hebrew Institute. Because I'm about to go real political on certain groups. I'm not talking about Democratic, Republican. I want this nation to declare the Ku Klux Klan a terrorist organization. I do not understand why they have not declared them as a terrorist organization. I don't understand that. I don't understand, quite frankly, you want to declare ISIS as a terrorist organization, but we have free lynching in this country against certain people. And we overlook that. It's okay. It's not okay. It's not okay with God anymore. It's not okay with him. And how many lives is it going to take before this nation will admit there's a problem? This isn't about black or white. This is about the heart, the condition of the heart and what's right. Do not think, America, that God is so fooled and we are so self-righteous. Okay, so self-righteous. Because ISIS are people of color, so yes, they're a terrorist organization. But people of color have to put up with terrorist organizations that feel free to lynch and shoot with no justice, no hay justicia. And God is a God of justice. And until we begin to call out and this nation makes certain things right, until we make certain things right, it is not going to be right. You understand? It's not a matter of crooked Hillary or lying Trump. Those are symptoms of what is very wrong in this country. You understand what I'm saying? You are believers. You are God's warriors. Do you understand what I'm saying? You are the mouthpiece, the hands, the feet, the ones who can call out God, and he will listen to you. You understand what I'm saying? Because you have the Torah, and you know what is right, you know what is righteous, okay? And to whom much is given, much is required. I'm going to say right now, part of the reasons believers are having problems in their lives right now are because we are not sighing and crying and calling out about justice in the land. Justice. See, okay, people screaming back crazy because someone kneels for the flag. Don't hear nobody with a video of people getting killed. No hay justicia. There's no justice because there's something very wrong in this country that will not be addressed. But God is going to address it. God is going to address it. We have a responsibility as believers. God is not a God who is colorblind or who cares about color. He doesn't care. We look like a rainbow in here. Okay. And that's, guess what? That's the way it's supposed to be. That's the way it's supposed to be. Okay. We have everyone from Native Americans to, regardless, Argentina. Okay. Italy. Australia, okay? How far can we go across the world? That's the way it's supposed to be, people. But we're supposed to be a people that represent the same God. And until we cry out for justice, and guess what? The ears of man are not going to hear it, but the ears of God will hear your voice. And when his people unite together and say, not just calling for mercy. You know why we want mercy? Because mercy, we don't want it to be too uncomfortable. You understand what I'm saying? The God that I serve can protect us in a nuclear fallout. I ain't worried about that. The God we serve and are covenant with. God gave us the example of Jeremiah. Jeremiah had provision from the government that was contrary to everything. He could go anywhere he wanted to. If he wanted to take a vacation, they told him, go. If you want to come with us, you can go. If you want to stay here, you can go. In fact, here's some money. You decide what it is you want to do. Hello.
Amen.
Okay. Elijah, no matter where Elijah went, he had somebody to take him in. now, calling out to God. We got the answers, people. We have the answers for what is wrong in this country. You understand what I'm saying? The blessings and the curses, there are reasons for them. There are reasons for that. God, in his mercy, has allowed certain things to go on. But the scales of justice are about to come back. Stop looking at what your eyes are seeing on earth. You understand what I'm saying? There's a reason why God is allowing a lot of this to go on, the craziness to go on. Okay. Your correct attitude about everything that is going on is really just to observe, see, and have a little fun with it. Okay? You understand what I'm saying? It comes up. We're going to debate back and forth, but guess what? I got your back, brother. You understand? I will never go against anybody, against you. Regardless of who you're voting for. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. We'll not do that. Don't get caught up in this. Get caught up in God. Get caught up in God. Get caught up in what God is doing for today. Get caught up and tell people. Show them this. Show them in the history books. Do you know, guess what? If they rewrite the history, you'll never understand reasons why for certain things because there'll be no reference for it for you to go back to. You understand one reason why certain things in history are being rewritten? And guess what? The Jews had it right. They will never let you forget about the Holocaust. Amen. I'm meeting with a Jewish group tomorrow. They will never let you forget because they understand about payback. Isn't it amazing that the very man that commanded over 6 million Jews, but many more millions than that, okay, to be shot and burned in ovens, wound up being shot and burned? Come on. Measure for measure. You understand what I'm saying? Measure for measure. God is not mocked. So understand that you have a boldness within you to stand up and say, God will not be mocked. When people want to know why, God will not be mocked. If people want to do the wrong thing, they're going to have the wrong results happen. That's a fact, Jack. Now, if you don't want the wrong thing to happen, then we've got to turn this thing around. It will not stop. Once again, consequences. There are going to be consequences. Okay, where there is no justice, then God will enact justice. My fear for America is the fact that she knew so many things going on and did nothing about it. You see, so God himself has to exact the justice. That's why you better be on the right side of this tour. You better be on the right that God is a just God. And what we see is the results of a just God. You understand what I'm saying? Don't cry, why me, why me? Okay. If you understand that, then guess what? God is going to make a change, even with you. Because we're trying so hard to identify with the sinful land. Let's identify with the kingdom of God. Everybody stand, please. Now, doom and gloom, okay. I know some people get upset with doom and gloom. I know our young friend who is not here can't handle doom and gloom, but the Bible is real. The Bible is real. You are real saints. God has a powerful work for you. The saints in the Bible dealt with this stuff. You understand what I'm saying? They weren't namby-pamby. They dealt with it. Okay? You need to know how to protect your family in this time. You understand what I'm saying? So what I'm giving you is how to protect your family because you're going to protect them through the truth. This is the reason why. This is what we need to do, family. Okay? This is how God is going to hit. If you don't know how the blessings come, you don't understand how the curses come too. But every single area, okay, and know how to protect your families. And that's what this is about. Because if you know what he's going to do, he also gives you the remedy on how to protect you and your family during it as long as you are obedient. Remember, your disobedience can cause your family, okay, problems. Your obedience can pull them up out of the depths of hell. You understand? By telling them the reason why. Okay? Father God, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Israel, we come before you, O Heavenly Father. We thank you, O Heavenly Father, for the will and the word that you are giving us this day. We thank you, Lord, that when you called, we heard your voice. Oh, God, we heard your voice and answered the call, O Heavenly Father. Who are we, O Heavenly Father, that you should even have called us, O Heavenly Father, and blessed us with the Torah, O Lord. Lord, we were so lost, and we didn't even know we were lost. We thought we had been found, but we were still lost. We thought we were in the light, but we were still in darkness. And yet, you gave us your Torah and turned the light on. And now, Lord, we were blind, but yes, we see, Lord. We see, O Heavenly Father. And Lord, I'm asking you, O Heavenly Father, bless your people with the gifts of wisdom and understanding. Because wisdom and understanding and knowledge, O Heavenly Father, of what to do, how to do it, why it is being done, okay, according to your will, is what will help them succeed in these days. Make them the light in very dark places, O Heavenly Father. Lord, provide the provision that they are going to need, O Heavenly Father. Open up doors that man has shut. Shut doors that the enemy would open to have them go through the wrong way. Father, grant unto them favor where they go. When they walk in the place, come the provision for them. So, Father, we acknowledge you this day as our sovereign God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, our creator, our redeemer, the mighty one of Jacob, the almighty God is our redeemer, Yeshua HaMashiach.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So, Father, as we enter in the covenant of the Sabbath this day through the blood of the Lamb of God, we humble ourselves and acknowledge your lordship over our life, O Heavenly Father. And we thank you that even now you are pouring out upon us blessings. We can't even imagine, Lord. We can't even understand what you're about to do for us. So, Father, I just want to thank you in advance. Father, if there be any sick among us, in the name of Yeshua, heal, stretch forth your hand, heal, O Heavenly Father. There be those that have some emotional needs that are going through some things, O Lord, that only you can solve. Hallelujah. Only you could solve them, O Heavenly Father. So, Father, we come before you in spirit and in truth, Lord. Show us what it is we need to do and give us the strength to do it, O Lord. Some of us are tired in our bodies. Renew every single cell, O Heavenly Father. Some of us are going through opposition on jobs. Father, move those opposers out and bring shalom into their circumstances, Father. Father, grant us favor where it is that we should go. Grant us wisdom and what to do with the resources you are giving us. And we want to thank you and praise you for all that you are doing. In the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach, let everyone say,
Amen.
Amen. All right, as we get ready, I'm going to go ahead.